Welcome to St. Paul's this morning. The processional hymn this morning is 347, The God of Abraham Prays.
Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Lord, have mercy upon us. And write both these, thy laws, in our hearts, we beseech thee.
Glory be to God on high, and on earth, peace and goodwill towards all. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee. We give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father.
Merciful God, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from our sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
The first reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, the 40th chapter, beginning to read at the 21st verse. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see, who created these? He who brings out their hosts and numbers them, calling them by name, because he is a great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Continuing with Psalm 147. Alleluia! How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor him with praise. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He counts the numbers of the stars and calls them by their names. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to his wisdom. The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the harp. He covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass to grow upon the mountains and green plants to serve mankind. He provides food for flocks and for the young ravens when they cry. He is not impressed by the might of a horse. He has no pleasure in the strength of a man. But the Lord has pleasure in those who fear him, in those who await his gracious favor. God of the universe, Lord of life, give us grace to see you in all your works, in all creatures, all people, and in our hearts, that we may faithfully serve you and worthily praise your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The second reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Verses 16 to 23. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe betide me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward, but if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself was not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under order to Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, so that I might by any means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
As they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew, with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told Jesus about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went through Galilee, proclaiming the message of the synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is the Sabbath, a very busy one for Jesus. He's already attended worship in the synagogue, taught from Scripture during the same service, and cast out an unclean spirit, plus healing a man. Following that, he went with the disciples to Simon Andrew's home, where he healed Simon's mother-in-law. As word of all this traveled, we are told that at sunset, the end of the Sabbath, the whole city of Capernaum gathered at the house, and Jesus ministered to many who wanted his healing touch and the hope that he brought to them. Today's passage concludes with Jesus telling his disciples, "Let us go to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came to do." But after this conversation, Jesus does something that we learn over time is very typical of him. Early in the morning, before dawn, when everyone else is still asleep, Jesus goes off by himself to pray. It is a time to re-energize, a time to be still with God. Most of all, though, it is for Jesus a time to focus on two things. He knows what he is called to do, But this time of prayer is a time for him to pay attention to why he is ministering to all these people, and then for him to bring clearly to mind whose mission he is called to serve in the world. Sometimes it is immensely difficult to feed your own spirit, and all the gifts you offer in ministry seem to dissolve into a series of tasks to be accomplished, especially when you are trying to be attentive to good outcomes that benefit people who need them. These are not just items on a to-do list. All the activity of the day has been important ministry in meeting the needs of others. It has been vital in some way to all who received it. Beyond that, what was offered was also critical to revealing the presence of God in the healing touch and in words of hope. Anyone who has spent time caring for someone who is ill, be it a 24-hour flu or terminal cancer, knows how physically and emotionally draining it can be to always be present and attentive, no matter how much empathy we feel for the person in need. Recall that in last Sunday's reading, Jesus got a foretaste of what his life as a healer, teacher, and yes, Messiah would demand of him. Today, we see the impact of that realization. The needs of the world and the people are endless. Most of us have been so overwhelmed by demands on our time, our resources, and probably most tellingly on our mental and emotional health, especially this year, that we recognize the toll on Jesus, and he's just getting started in his ministry. Jesus did what we often neglect to do. Jesus took the time to nourish his soul with prayer, conversation with God. That was what renewed his energy and gave him clarity about the direction of his ministry. It restored his passion for his work and for the people he encountered. Then Jesus left Capernaum to resume his role in God's mission. Last week's scripture told us that everyone around Jesus recognized the authority of his teaching because it was clear that God's truth was an intricate part of his being. What we are talking about here is something in church language called passionate spirituality. We need to recognize and wrestle with what passionate spirituality truly is about. It is not the buzzword of the moment. It is a challenge, and it starts with a simple question as an annual vestry looms on the horizon. What are your hopes and your vision for your congregation in 2021? What will feed your understanding of what you have to offer in a positive way to God's vision for this planet we inhabit? How many of us are so often open to God that you literally let God inhabit your souls and guide your way of being in the world with others? If we have difficulty with these questions on a personal level, how can we expect to answer them fully as a congregation? If we have no answer as a congregation, how can we reasonably expect others to want to share in our vision of the ministry, especially if it seems little more than another to-do list of tasks? It doesn't work that way, and somewhere deep in us, we know that. We have to find the courage and the discipline to follow the model we have just been taught by Jesus. It is something called centering prayer. We likely know the terminology, but we need to think about what centering prayer could look like for us, individually and corporately. Centering prayer is time with God, where we listen and we absorb the vision God offers for what might be, and then in faith, we collectively roll up our sleeves and get on with it. The message from Isaiah is about restoration. Restoration of the relationship with God. It is a call to people who live in exile to have hope. It is a call to remember who God is to them and how God has helped Israel in the past. Come to God, the prophet says. so that everything can be put into perspective. The challenge is to wait upon God, to listen to God, and to speak to God in prayer so that God can have the means to be at work in our midst, restoring us to spiritual health as God's plan unfolds. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Creator is the everlasting God, the Creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and in his understanding no one can fathom. That's all a poetic way of saying, put aside the cynicism and the negativity. Remember what God has done for you now and what he has done in the past. Recall who God is and what God's purpose is, and stay in touch with that. How did Jesus go to the synagogue and the Sabbath week in and week out? And why did he go to the Sabbath, to the synagogue? Why did he read scripture and keep the law? Why did he persist in finding quiet places to pray? Why did he withdraw from the crowds and from his own disciples to wait and to listen to God? This is what gave him strength and purpose. This is what kept him centered on God's work. Time with God, listening, the core of centering prayer. Restoration, relationship with God, with God's strengthened and returning of the Spirit in all of us brings hope. A vision for what will be, maybe. Reread Isaiah 40, 21 to 31 and ask yourself this question. How is God present in this congregation right now, even though doors are closed and locked against COVID-19? I pray that you will find what you are seeking the answer is a hope-filled experience. God has a purpose for this congregation. When we seek learning in Scripture, when we invite God to speak in us instead of forcing God to shout to be heard, God will move the people of St. Paul's in ways no congregation is capable of achieving on its own. To those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. What a vision to live into. Thanks be to God. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated for the prayers of the people. Hear our prayers for the people of St. Paul's, gracious God. Give us inquiring hearts and minds to seek your truth, and inspire us to do your will in all we undertake. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, may we be instruments of your love and grace in this community. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. In the Toronto Diocesan Cycle of Prayer, we pray for Holland Deanery. In the Anglican Cycle of Prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Burundi. In our parish, we name those who are sick, in need, or distress. Ron, Paul, Robin, Bobby, Richard, Barb, Susan, Joe, Holly, John, Shirley, Diana, Mark, Barry, Marissa, Helena, Tanya, Linda and Alan, Garth, Alan, Tammy, Patty Ann, Nicole, Jackson, Patricia, Grant, Ross, Bill, Heather. We remember our children with special needs, Lincoln and Nate. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For peace from on high and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We pray for our Primate Linda, our Metropolitan Anne, our Bishops Andrew and Rosilla, for our clergy, Interim Priest Canon Gloria, and Honorary Assistant Canon Greg, Youth Leader Dan, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Elizabeth, our Queen, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the city of Kawartha-Lake, for every city and community, and for those who live in them in faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For good weather and for abundant harvests for all to share, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who travel by land, water, or air, for the sick and the suffering, for prisoners and captives, and for their safety and health and salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our deliverance from all affliction, strife, and need, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the absolution and remission of our sins and offenses, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have died, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Remembering all the saints, we commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our God. To thee, O Lord. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt hear their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. For thou, Father, art good and loving, and we glorify thee through thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things and judge of all people. We acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And always with you.
The offertory hymn is for all our blessings. God of compassion and forgiveness, receive our offering this day and make us one with him in our peace. Jesus Christ, our Savior. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so too.
It is very meet, right, and abound in duty, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord. Holy Father, almighty everlasting God, creator and preserver of all things. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who in the substance of our mortal flesh manifested forth his glory, that he might bring us out of darkness into his own marvelous light. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord, glory and thanksgiving be unto thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy dost give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memorial of that his precious death till his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, holy institution, remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, we, thy humble servants, with all thy holy church, remembering the precious death of thy beloved Son and his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again in glory, to make before thee in the sacrament of holy bread of eternal life and the cup of everlasting salvation, the memorial which he hath commanded. We praise thee, we bless thee, we thank thee, and we pray to thee, Lord our God. And we entirely desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Most humbly beseech thee to grant that by the merits and the death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And we pray that by the power of thy Holy Spirit, all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, O Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather the crumbs under that table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Grant us peace. For those at home who may wish to make their spiritual communion by joining in this prayer, I invite you now. I worship and adore you, Lord Jesus Christ, present in the Holy Sacrament and in your people. who are gathered in spirit. In this moment, I join with them to receive you in my heart and in my community. May you, enthroned by the altar, now be enthroned in my heart. May you, who give yourself to us again, fill us with grace and heavenly blessing. Even as I am fed, may my hunger for you and for your reign of justice and peace increase, that I may with your spirit work that for that day when you your reign shall come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Share in this heavenly banquet, be instruments of your peace on earth. In the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Our closing hymn is All Creatures of Our God and King.
Your voice.
depart in peace in the name of the Lord.